Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, The Lost Boys. What does it mean to be a man today?
He's got to go out there and provide for his family.
I see myself as inferior to my partner because I don't earn as much as she does.
What is masculinity to you?
Everyone looks at masculinity as toxic masculinity. There's no, like, positive masculinity.
Violence and aggression helps men leave genes in the next generation.
You think it's heading down a road to misogyny?
I think it's already there.
When I'm on the battlefield, I feel a massive sense of pride. For me, the knight character is never something that I really had growing up. I certainly wasn't strong, able to defend myself and able to protect others. I did not have a big stature, so that's kind of why I'm drawn to that character. Being able to physically overpower someone and be able to exert your influence across a battlefield is very empowering. My name is Tad Lyons, and I am 31 years old. So I play a character named Sergeant Kaelin Hellfire. So LARPing stands for Live Action Roleplay, so L-A-R-P. LARP is where you take on a character and then you act as your character would. Today we are doing the first Battlecry Community Day. So this is essentially all four of our chapters coming together, the Central Coast, Wollongong, Bathurst, and Western Sydney, all coming together for a tournament. I didn't really want to participate initially. I thought it was pretty nerdy and not really something that I wanted to be seen doing. I was dragged along kicking and screaming. It was a pretty hard decision to get involved initially through fear of judgment. My upbringing was in a military household. It was quite regimented. Growing up, the idea of a man was one of strength and someone who was reasonably immune to emotion. You don't rely on other people. You don't ask for help. You soldier through it.
Thank you and welcome to Battlecry's first Community Day.
So I started Battlecry January 2018. I've created something with a group of people that no one else really offers and that a lot of people take on as a lifestyle. Being able to put on these personality traits of being, you know, incredibly macho and very masculine, and then just being able to take them off again whenever you feel like it is a very freeing experience. I guarantee if I was not able to do something like this, then I'd probably be displaying a lot of those traits in a very toxic way.
Thank you so much for being here. Tad, you mentioned that if you didn't do live action role play, you'd resort to toxic alternatives. What do you mean by that?
For me, before I started doing LARP and getting involved in that world, I was very heavily addicted into the world of online gaming. For me, that's a very toxic subculture, which exacerbated a lot of my very toxic traits, my aggression response, my competition, my unhealthy level of competition, and my intolerance of other people.
Does Kaelin, your character, have any masculine traits that you aspire to?
Yes. I think the biggest traits would be the honour code that the character abides by. For me, honour is something that I still try my best to have in this day and age. You trust someone at their word and you do your best to uphold yours. When you make a promise to someone, you keep it.
When you were a kid, what did you think it meant to be a man?
Being a man was someone who was stoic and the provider, the leader of a household, the person who you would turn to make tough decisions, and a pillar of strength that other people can lean on.
Did that man show emotions, the man that you thought you should be?
Certain emotions were permissible. Any form of emotion which was interpretable as weakness was also something that wasn't something you'd show.
You'd planned on joining the Defence Force. Why did you change your mind on that?
My father served, my grandfather served, my younger brother now serves. So I felt the pull, but for me it was the the traits that I saw in, I guess, what it took to become successful in that line of work was not something that I wanted for myself.
So after you left the military, where did that leave you?
I had to really reinvent myself and try and find a new direction. I studied art, fine art, and tried to do something that made me happy. And it's taken me a long time to get there, but I think I finally found something.
Will, your first job out of school was on a remote cattle station. You later served in the military and then the Australian Federal Police. What drew you to those lines of work?
Just part of my DNA, I think. You know, you get to jump out of planes and do all sorts of things like, you know, and you're firing guns and all that sort of thing. So it's a bit adventurous and a lot of fun.
What does it mean to be a man today?
I know there's so much happening in the world today. To be a man today, you have to be true to yourself. And there's so many things going on. So I think there's so much, you know, a lot of BS. It's hard for youngsters sometimes and even the older fellas to decipher the way that should be. It's so easy to get lost or distracted in the world today.
You're 56.
Yep.
Has the definition of manliness changed in your lifetime?
I think manliness is still the same. The perception of what a man is may have changed.
When do you think that started to happen?
Probably in the evolution in the 70s and with equality and all those sorts of things. You know, the perception of manliness or what manliness is may have changed and grown.
Josh, you were raised by a strong feminist mother. What male influences have you had in your life?
Yeah, she certainly was. Obviously, my dad was still driving me around to sport 5-6 times a week. I went through the traditional pathway. I went through a private boys' school, which can be, you know, at its best, can sort of foster a sense of manhood, but at its worst is full of bullying and a lot of brutality. You know, the rugby clubs, competitive basketball, again, all about competition and winning. I was an army reservist for a quite long period of time. And again, at its best, defence and the army can really be about a sense of brotherhood and sisterhood and about promoting you to become your best. But at its worst, it's also got that hard edge.
So in those spaces, how would you describe masculinity?
I'd say there's certainly a sense of an ideal type of what masculinity should be and what manhood should be. It's about strength. It's about winning, just about at any cost.
Danielle, you're a researcher specialising in evolutionary psychology. How has evolution affected male behaviour?
What evolution has produced are really complex contingencies between environment and behaviour. Greater reproductive success is the ultimate currency of evolution. So it's quite simple principle. If you have, you know, more reproductive success than other members of your generation, then your genes will be overrepresented in the next generation. And after multiple generations, those genes that result in greater reproductive success, of course, become widespread in the population. That's really how evolution works in its most basic way. And so when you're seeing men engaging in aggressive type behaviour or violent type behaviour, the reason why those mechanisms exist that to support that behaviour is ultimately because there are circumstances in which that behaviour is adaptive. Violence and aggression helps men leave genes in the next generation. And that's why those genes are here in our generations.
Andrew, what are your thoughts about men and biology?
It comes down to the evolution and having good male role models. And definitely, I feel like it's a hormonal thing as well. Typically, men that have a lot of testosterone, they're perceived as more masculine. They have more aggression and they're more stronger. So they're perceived in the public as more masculine. So going back centuries ago, the caveman eras and stuff. But at the end of the day, the man's role is to really go out there, you know, hunt for food, bring it back, provide for his family, protect his family, and just really put himself out there on the firing line. Looking at modern day masculinity, you know, essentially that's what a male has to do. He's got to go out there and provide for his family and also protect him, be willing to protect. Mm.
So what is masculinity to you?
It's being able to be a leader, take on responsibilities for not only himself but also other people.
Dom, do you think there's a way that a man should look and act?
I think if you want to be deemed or viewed positively by both your male peers and by females, I think there's a way that you should act. And if you were to take any action movie you've ever seen and look at the male protagonist, you could easily identify certain masculine traits. Mm. So we've got strength and bravery and resilience. And those are ways that you should act if you want to be perceived as masculine and if you want to be perceived generally positively. There's definitely a flip side to that, you know? There's, I'm not denying toxic masculinity exists, but I don't think that it's the only form of masculinity. I think that's the biggest problem, is that everyone looks at masculinity as toxic masculinity and there's no real alternate term. There's no, like, positive masculinity or anything like that.
You mean if there's that kind of strength, movie-style role, mm-hmm. that's seen as toxic as opposed to something positive?
You'll have people who act in a traditionally masculine way now who are being ostracised for it and criticised, and while it can be viewed as more attractive, the narrative is that it is wrong and it is toxic mm-hmm. and it is chauvinistic.
So it's less encouraged now, in a sense?
Yeah, despite the fact that it is still prevalent, it's still desired, but it's discouraged.
What values were you taught about being a man when you were growing up?
I mean, I come from a pretty open, left-leaning family, quite progressive. Explicitly, there wasn't as much emphasis on being a man, but implicitly, I definitely saw it. Like in my family, my parents' relationship, I saw my father as a stronger role model that my mum could, like, lean on for support. And I think that's positive. When I was in school, it was always the boys that were more masculine, that were more popular, that had a better time. And it was the case when my dad was at school, and I think it will still be the case in 50 years. Despite what's being told and despite the discouragement of masculinity, it's still always going to be the case that these are people that are more successful.
That modelling that you saw as a younger man, did you feel like you were able to live up to that?
I was very late to puberty, so I didn't look like a man. If you see a 15-year-old who's, like, 5 foot nothing with no hair on his face, he's obviously going to have a harder time at school. And I was naturally quite sensitive, and I still am. Mm. So those were things that had to be overcome. And it took quite a long time, and I feel like I'm still doing that. And I'm not saying that it's good. I'm not saying that toxic masculinity in the form of bullying and things like that are good, but they exist. Mm. And they have always existed. And even people who are opposed to the idea of toxic masculinity, they still perpetuate a lot of these ideals.
Ricky, what was your first concept of manliness?
I blame the Ninja Turtles. It was the action figures for sure. A lot of the figurines and the movies. Mm-hmm. And then when I put that aside, it was like, as a teenager, wrestling, right. Anime and, you know, action films with Arnold Schwarzenegger and all those. So that's where it definitely started.
So the tough action guys,
yeah.
Or turtles.
The hero. So going to school and noticing that I looked different and I didn't fit in, I guess, made me want to gravitate more towards masculinity and those things that were celebrated in school.
Did it feel like there was a sort of pecking order at school?
Absolutely.
Right. So who was at the top and who was at the bottom?
At the top, there were the bigger, stronger kids, but I was the skinny kid in high school, and that was a big insecurity of me.
Here's how you dealt with those feelings of insecurity.
As a young man, I got all my cues about what a man should be through media and societal, I guess, conditioning. When it came around to my physical size, a lot smaller than the other guys, there definitely was this sense that something was lacking, or I wasn't what a man or, you know, teenage boy should be. I started weightlifting with 2 dumbbells that I borrowed from a friend at around age 16. I felt it was like this secret, because I thought people would look at me and be like, You're tiny, you're scrawny, why you bother working out? I think as a young adult stepping into the world, it really helped with my confidence. It was, I think, when later on, after I'd spent a few years working out, I started to then question more of the negative aspects of it, like how much time it was taking away from me. It was the thing that was such a source of my self-esteem, so I didn't know who I'd be without it. So in a way, I was almost kept like prisoner to it. So around the period of 2013, 14, I was living in Melbourne actually, and that's when I found myself involved in street poetry. I just had the idea one day that I could use my words and kind of bring them to the street in type of gallery format. And I was like, I'll get a typewriter and pieces of card and kind of create this really textile kind of experience for people. I didn't really develop any real traction with it till 2020 and COVID happened, and people were, all they were doing was spending time walking around doing 5 kilometer loops of the area. And yeah, people enjoyed looking for them. And it really, you know, meant a lot to me that what I was doing was now making an impact, more so during a real difficult time.
Did you feel differently as a man when you redefined yourself through your street poetry?
Absolutely. I think at that stage, I had realised that that body that I'd built was really like this armour. Mm. And while it was celebrated by those around me, it was also protecting this part of me, or keeping this part of me that was very vulnerable and hidden, not given that chance to be authentic. Through the writing itself, I guess, it enabled me to get what I got from weightlifting, which was this sense of control over my life and my story.
Sometimes when we take off armour, we can feel a bit vulnerable. Were there moments when you kind of wanted to put it back on?
Absolutely. That was the choice where I had to choose to let the armour fall, and I'd say the real me then came out of that process.
I was worried about a few personal things and I was quite stressed about it. And I expressed that to my partner at the time, and her only reaction was, man up.
Man up.
That was it, yeah.
Next week on Insight, how are Australians redefining expectations about growing old?
I want to try new things. Last week, for the first time in my life, I smoked a bong.
Do you keep a lid on your stress levels as well?
I don't allow stress into my life.
There's an African proverb that says, when an old person dies, a library dies with them. The idea of just because they're over 60, putting them in a heap, I just find that really unthinkable.
Alan, what are the first things women notice when they meet you?
I look like I have that tough image, but it doesn't match up with that. When I start talking, I'm a bit more gentle, a bit more thoughtful.
Have you ever tried to change any of your characteristics to appeal to women?
I guess it's just recognising that I have a soft voice, particularly on camera. It's part of my job. I need to talk, public speaking. So taking my time, enunciating words more clearly, having a more confident voice, controlling what I'm saying, yeah.
So you really think about that before you're speaking in order to shift that perception?
It depends when. Using my voice to command attention, respect, yeah, sure, I'll use it then. Or when I was a firefighter for 6 years,
I would definitely use my voice to kind of communicate with people. But with friends, not so much.
From your experience, what are women looking for in a man?
Well, I guess it varies depending on the woman, and sitting here as a single guy, I'm clearly not an expert. But I would say through my personal experiences, confidence, being a man that's sure of himself, 6 foot and over. I'm sure we've all read that on a dating profile before. And surprisingly, irrespective of what level the woman is in her career, it seems that she wants a man who earns more than that,
right,
which I found was strange.
Mm.
Yeah.
What about emotions or strength?
It really depends on the individual, because I don't want to paint the narrative that we often see in the media, where it's there's toxic masculinity and men aren't supportive of each other showing emotions, whereas women are supportive of it. And I found some of the best examples have been my male friends who have supported me through tough times. And probably my worst examples have been certain women that I've dated.
And what would be an example of that?
So there was one time where I had a year-long contract at work and it was coming to a close and I was worried about where I was going to go next with my work, as well as a few personal things. And I was quite stressed about it, having a bit of trouble sleeping. And I expressed that to my partner at the time. And her only reaction was, man up.
Man up.
That was it, yeah.
And how did you feel when you were told to man up?
So I was shocked, a little bit hurt.
What did man up mean to you?
She didn't want to deal with that problem.
Andrew, are you emotionally open with your partners?
I feel like it's for a long-term partner and for that stability of a relationship to really develop and for that growth in that relationship, it's important for the man to be vulnerable with his partner and pull down the walls. I think that if a guy enters a relationship and he's consistently like an emotional roller coaster, up and down throughout the journey of their dating or relationship duration, the woman's gonna eventually lose attraction for him because it's a very feminine trait. And she's, at the end of the day, she is looking for a man that is stable and steady in his emotions, but okay to display his vulnerabilities.
You're a dating coach.
Yes.
When your male students first reach out to you,
yeah.
What in general are they struggling with?
The common thing that I hear is, Andrew, my life is going good in my career and everything like that, but I just struggle to even meet women or even get out on dates. If I'm lucky to get out on dates, I find it tough to get beyond the first date. And another common challenge is, what do I even say to girls? So they need a bit of clarity and guidance in terms of how to talk to a woman.
What do you teach your students?
We teach them how to become a lot more confident, how to develop social skills in all sorts of environments, and we also work on things like personal hygiene and grooming.
Josh, you're a political sociologist. What are your thoughts on dating schools for men?
Yeah, look, I think there's always been some form of dating advice that in more recent years we've seen a sort of dark turn in that space. We've seen the emergence of, example, pickup artists,
right.
Who basically train men in tactics to pick up women in public spaces in order to sleep with them. So we're talking things like negging, which is basically making a woman feel bad about herself, emotional manipulation, to then raise that man's status in relation to the woman. And so what we've seen is the emergence of big charismatic individuals. Most recently, we've seen people like Roosh, Andrew Tate and others talking about how to pick up women and this essentialisation of what it is to be a man. Mm. You know, that you have to have money and resources and status when really it comes down to respect and love. It's a dangerous turn for women in many respects because it ties in to a broader ideological orientation. So we've seen some charismatic individuals talk about the legalisation of rape. We've talked about some pretty extreme ideas out there that are shaping the way that young men in particular view women and their relationship to women.
And when you say dark turn, you think it's heading down a road to misogyny?
I think it's already there. Women are there to have sex with. They're only going to value high status men. So how can we make them either think we're high status or how can we manipulate them into feeling so bad about themselves that they view us in a positive way?
Andrew, have you ever been called a pickup artist?
A few times, not a lot.
In terms of that kind of world of guys who might be trying to elevate themselves and lower the status of women, do you ever get students like that?
So we don't take on board those type of guys and we particularly distanced ourselves away from that community, especially when I made that decision that I wanted to start this company up, because I definitely seen the results of the whole pickup community, the impact that it's made. It can definitely go down some dark paths, like especially when guys are growing up and they don't get success in the dating space, they're very vulnerable and they're trying to look for answers.
We heard Josh mention some of those voices out there, like Andrew Tate.
Yeah.
Andrew Tate is one of a number of influential personalities online. Let's take a look.
Bang out the machete, boom in her face, then grip her up by the neck. Shut up, bitch!
He's a legit world champion kickboxer who doesn't buy any pussy bullshit.
I don't think the world has ever been equal. That the modern society we live in has been built by men. Let's cut the crap.
Children are being taught that in no uncertain terms that being a male, being a boy, is some type of evil gender.
Because the sexual revolution has castrated men in terms of their ambition, in terms of their mobility.
We're gonna end up with a generation of women who view almost all men as inadequate.
They're lonesome and they don't know what to do.
No, you stay in the house. You don't go nowhere. You're not, no restaurants, no clubs, nothing.
And that's what's resonating with young people.
Andrew, are these men promoting masculinity or misogyny?
They definitely come strongly off misogynistic views. And there is definitely a mixture of masculinity in there, right? And you've got to really take it as a grain of salt, but then really understand the goods from the bad. But I think people can definitely, especially young men, they can see this stuff and just mold into what Andrew Tate is preaching. Mm.
Josh, we've heard about this growing movement encouraging a return to that sort of traditional masculinity. What are we talking about here?
We're talking about it cutting across the far right, who again argue for women to return to the home so that men can go out and become breadwinners and reassert that, you know, women are there to breed, basically. But then obviously there's the manosphere as well, which is a more recent phenomenon.
Manosphere.
The manosphere. So it's an online environment of misogynists that can be broadly categorised along four primary themes. We're talking men's rights activists, specifically who are anti-feminist, who have the idea that women have subverted society and its institutions, that the family court's inherently corrupt and favours women. We talk about men going their own way, which is a broad coalition and movement of men who believe that women should be ignored entirely. We're then talking about pickup artists, who we've already covered off on. And then there's incels, involuntary celibates. Now, many men gather online who basically claim that they can't have sex with women. It's women's fault for rejecting them in favour of higher status men. And so they get into these online communities and self-flagellate about how horrible and terrible their lives are.
You specialise in masculinity and extremism. What does your research show about how widely held these views are?
On the one hand, we can say that the majority of men don't subscribe to violent misogyny or any of these beliefs, but there are concerning patterns emerging. So in a survey that we conducted in 2019 across 28 countries with 19,000 respondents, including Australia, we found that about 5% of men subscribe to the proposition that women don't deserve equal rights to men. Right. So that's 5%. But then we talk soft prejudice, so we talk that the idea that rights of women have gone too far. And we're talking 35 to 40% of men in Australia in that survey. And the numbers are most concerning amongst young men aged 18 to 35. And they're the men who are being immersed in this world of social media and this messaging and the manosphere.
That 30 to 40% women's rights have gone too far. What do you think that's come down to?
We have to take a bit of a history lesson and look back at what's shaped the world to the point that we are at. And if you look at post-World War II, we had the welfare state, which really catered to looking after working men's needs. That lasted for about 15, 20 years, but then we saw the individualistic atomisation that emerged from the Chicago School. So the idea that government needs to limit itself to one or two key areas and the market should decide. Trade union membership, which offered a form of solidarity, belonging to working people, was at about 50 or 60% of society. And it's now about 9 or 10%, in particular highest amongst women in the public sector. And that's across Western countries. If you're looking at church attendance, again, 40, 50, 60%. And that's dropped down to 10%. And church offered a sense of community and a sense of status and belonging as well. So we've seen these institutions decline over a period of time. And we've seen, on the other hand, an uptick in
people call it neoliberalism or free market or monetarism, opened up the labour markets, precarious work. Blue-collar men no longer had a job for life. Over time, we've seen that the service sector and the feminisation of work in many respects. We've seen women enter the workforce, highly capable, competent women now, competing for the same jobs as men. And we're seeing in the white-collar sector that many of these men, the company man who had the job for life, no longer do so. Mm. And so that's bred a level of resentment.
In terms of those more extreme ideologies, why do ideologies like that take hold?
It's a really important question, and it's one that's constantly debated in academia. For me, it comes down to basically, in particular, what we're seeing is young men searching for a source of meaning. They're looking for respect, they're looking for recognition, they're looking for a status, and they're looking for something they believe has sort of been denied to them. So these extremist groups or even far-right populist movements in particular target young men and men, in particular reasserting the role of men in society, reasserting the role that man should be the head of the household, women should be at home having babies.
Jay, you have three sons, two are teenagers. Do you talk to them about being a man or growing up as a young man in the world and what that might look like?
We talk to them about being a person.
Mm.
I'm very lucky in that I've got a partner who... we're very equal in how we run our home, in how we operate, in the fact that we both work. And when we talk to our children, we talk to them about, you know, being a good human being a good citizen, being a good community member. And, you know, it's less about being a good man or a good woman. Obviously, there are certain things that boys are more inclined towards. You know, all my kids play sport. They all do karate. They do MMA. They're very active boys. But they socialise with a lot of girls as well. And, you know, it's very important to us as parents, as a couple, that they see the world as humans, not just male and female, because we don't want them to feel that the things that they choose to do and the things that they're interested in and the things that they're drawn towards are good or bad because they fit in a particular box or not.
Dom, you worked hard to overcome your unhappiness as a teenager. What happened when you were 20?
I felt that I lost my direction when I was a late teenager. Mm. And I had a number of years in a relationship where I wasn't sure. I was happy in the relationship. I wasn't sure of where I was going as a person. And so I came out of that and I felt disenfranchised. I hadn't seen my friends enough, my male friends. Obviously, you spend more time with your girlfriend than when you would with your male friends. I hadn't worked on myself. I didn't think that I had progressed in terms of becoming more of a man. And it made me feel quite insecure.
When you came out of that relationship, did you see women differently because of how you felt and because of that disconnection you felt?
Sure. I think there are values that are often advocated for by women, such as being emotional and being sensitive and being caring, values that aren't traditionally masculine. But while they might be verbal proponents of these values, it's not always the case that they truly want to see them. Mm. So I found that in my relationships and also in my friends' relationships, they've kind of decided that they will embody these more feminine traits and be more feminine with their partners, and it ultimately has led to a lot of them getting broken up with. Wow. Literally, I had a friend who told me that, whose girlfriend called me and told me that she couldn't deal with him being sad and upset with her all the time. It's like women are more likely to prefer a man who is seen as a strong provider.
Do you think it's become more difficult, in a sense, to navigate your place as a man in this world?
Absolutely. I mean, if you look historically, it's been pretty unanimous, the opinion of what a man is and what a man looks like and what a man should look like. In the past, say, 10 years, when I've become an adult male, I've seen changes in the culture. Mm. And those changes in the culture are obviously advocating for men to be more sensitive, less masculine. Masculinity is demonised, and toxic masculinity is a term used all the time where there's no alternative.
You've just graduated from a psychology degree. Did you feel like you could be more expressive about your ideas at university as opposed to school?
No, I would say the opposite. So my university degree is 4/5 women, often just the only boy in the room. And I guess I am quite outspoken, hence why I'm here today. I think that saying any kind of view that doesn't go completely into the current popular, I guess, progressive narrative can lead you to be ostracised. I mean, I've had countless arguments with the girls from uni that
What's
now
an example
is
of that?
Gender quotas. Because there's a big movement towards gender quotas for courses like engineering, for getting women into like STEM fields that they're not represented in. And engineering and psychology are a good parallel to draw because they have the opposite ratios, where it's 5-1 in psychology for women and 5-1 for men in engineering. And so when you see that and you hear that, like, we need more women into engineering, women can get scholarships into engineering, they're more likely to get placements as a result of affirmative action. And to me, that makes no sense, especially when you consider the two fields. Like engineering, it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. If you make a strong bridge, you make a strong bridge. But I think in fields like psychology and teaching, where the balance is definitely in the favor of females, it does matter to an extent if you're having a male psychologist or a male teacher. And the data shows that as well. A majority of men would rather see a male psychologist, but most are unable to because there's such a small amount.
So if you were having that discussion at uni, would mm-hmm. that be shut down?
So there's certain girls that would shut it down, absolutely, that discount every other opinion I might have and my general political beliefs or relationships with women outside of this one perspective. And that level of ostracism is definitely pushing men towards misogyny.
Josh, are males treated unfairly?
I mean, where do you start? What we're getting an insight into here is the victimisation complex that really pervades the manosphere. Let's talk about the consistent structural inequality that prevents women, educated as they are, from progressing in society into positions of power. How many prime ministers have we had in this country who are women? How many senior female leaders and role models in this country can you name in positions of great power who are women? At the end of the day, it doesn't change the fact that structurally women face significant inequality in society, continue to do so.
Will, what do you think? Is there an unfairness? Have men had to sacrifice anything because of women's equality? Like, you know, have those balances shifted?
I think the key point for me taken away from this in perspective is, you know, like from an incarceration or jail perspective, majority of men, suicide rates highest of men, divorce rates, you know, the men can be left with absolutely zip, you know, and go through a child support agency and then struggle to see their kids. And, you know, there's a lot of things in the mix that are filtering down, and you've got kids growing up without that male role model. So I think there's a real need for stable male role models in this whole picture of just good, who are good humans, good men, who, you know, can be masculine or whatever it is, and just being comfortable in that, because that's, you know, that's life.
Like Josh just gave a number of statistics, and sure, they might be the case, but one statistic that I think is so potent when you're looking at the well-being of men and women in our society is the data on suicides. And the suicide rate is almost 3 times as high in men. So how can you look at that, which is to me the clearest identifier of how someone is doing mentally, and say, oh yeah, men are almost 3 times as likely to kill themselves than women, but they're so lucky, they're so fortunate, they're so privileged, and in the same breath be criticising them for all these things that are apparently their fault. It's not the fault of a man that for most of history men have been in control, a man today. When you talk about patriarchal structures, there's a very small amount of men at the top, and that's what we talked about in terms of dating and wanting to appear more powerful. The reason is because there is a small amount of men at the top, and for the men underneath them, their livelihood is not a positive one. They're not living happy lives, and that's why male depression is such a prevalent issue, because men aren't living these wonderful, privileged lives that likes to be espoused in the media.
Mm. Will, what is the solution to this?
Men are very simple creatures. You know, we are. but we need some stable male role models who are masculine and not masculine and whatever they are, but are just humble, good men and stand strong.
Given your background working in the military and also in the Australian Federal Police, do you see a positive to that sort of structure? Would you like to see more young men in those spaces?
I think across the board, male and female, I think national service across the board is a good thing.
National military service?
No, not national military service, but it includes the military. So I'm talking about a national service of Team Australia. So fireys, ambos, police, army, navy, air force and rural sector. If you filter every child who's left school out to those areas, you talk about thousands and thousands of jobs, and you're giving everyone a sense of purpose, a greater sense, a greater concept than just themselves. They then, not only that, everyone's on the same page. They realise, oh, okay, everyone's, you know, in a similar predicament. Everyone's earning good money. They're learning accountability, responsibility.
Jay, is that something that you would consider for your boys?
I think there should be freedom of choice, but I do love the idea of encouraging everybody to give back, because I think it is something that is definitely lacking in our society, is that sense of connectedness, that sense of purpose, the sense of this place is bigger than me. It's not just about my selfish needs. And I think that's something that is eroding society, and it's not a male or female thing.
Danielle, do you think it makes sense to expect equal childcare from men?
The majority of couples make decisions for the man to continue to work and women to look after the children, and it's not because of some inherent sexism, it's because that's what works for the majority of couples.
Typically, the boys are here, we get up, we have breakfast, normally some breakfast nonsense chat. Hi, Craig, how you doing?
Morning.
Good morning. Have a seat. It's time for breakfast. My name is Ian Reeves, and I'm a consultant working at one of the hospitals in Glasgow, Scotland, which is also my home. And it's home to my two sons, Ben and Craig, who are both 15. This is my breakfast here with the seeds and nuts and healthy things. Would you like any seeds and nuts and healthy things in yours as well? Scotland has quite progressive leave proposals for parents, so you're entitled to 18 weeks of unpaid leave. But my employer, the NHS, also enhances that by offering some paid leave as well, 4 weeks per child up until the age of 14. So it now means that you can consider taking parental leave to help with much later stages of life, which I think are just as difficult. Teenagers going through puberty, exam pressure, applying for university, all those times of life seem to be just as relevant and just as important in a child's development.
And you had a physics test earlier this week, didn't you? How'd that go?
Yeah, so I had one, it was first two on a Monday.
I think it's very important actually, especially like a sort of the stage of life that we're at, to have him around, because the sort of stuff we go through can be, like the exams that are all coming up could be quite tough, stressful.
Have a great day, Craig. Bye bye. A few weeks ago, my ex-wife was out of the country, so I took some parental leave to help with that week. The main advantage of doing that is that you don't end up frazzled at both ends of the spectrum. I think what parental leave gives people is the space that they can then manage to have a dedicated time for their family. Well, after I drop the boys off, I can then go and do the shopping, get the dinners organised, pick up any messages or laundry or anything else that I need to do during the day. And then I had more time at the end of the day to say, right, I can still take you to hockey. I can still take you to the gym. We do have time to watch something together. Boys in particular need positive role models, usually men, to help them understand where they're going to end up as men.
In Australia, parental leave is set to increase from 18 to 26 weeks by 2026. Will, you have three kids. Did you take time off to spend time with them?
No. No. Not when they were wee little people.
Do you think it's important for fathers to spend time with their sons?
Oh, without a doubt. It's really important for a man's health, for his welfare, to spend time with the kids. And it's good for the family, and I think there's only good things from it.
Josh, did you take parental leave?
I took as much as I could. I split it every opportunity I get to be involved. It is challenging also, though, obviously matching work and so on.
Danielle, do you think it makes sense to expect equal childcare from men?
Oh, Okay, that's a really big question, and it really depends on what you mean by equal childcare from men. So thinking about it from an evolutionary and biological perspective, a lot of people make the mistake of thinking that men are selected for to sort of provide and to provide the resource, but men have also been selected for to be parents. One of the most important determinants of female preferences, partner preferences, are indicators of whether or not they're going to be a good father. Women really value that a lot. And so, and of course we've heard today that, you know, men value being a parent as well. Men want to be around their children. So from a perspective of what would make people happy and what would make families functional and what would give children the best experiences, from that perspective, I would say yes. Yes, I would love to see it become the norm that mothers and fathers contribute equally to childcare and take equal time off work.
Is there a flip side to that?
There's a big flip side. And at this juncture, I really want to say that the gender inequalities and the structural inequalities that actually favour women, because nobody is acknowledging that we do have these structural inequalities that are favouring women. The only thing in the narrative, in the popular narrative, is that all of the structural inequalities favour men. The reason why I bring this up now in the context of parental care is because the majority of couples make decisions for the man to continue to work. And that those big society-wide statistics that we look at where we say, oh, yes, it's structural sexism and it's patriarchy and it's women not being allowed to work and women not getting opportunities for promotion and things like that. And that's not what I've seen in my field. I'm in academia. In my field, it is. I very much am sympathetic to the arguments that you were raising about how there are just some political perspectives in academia that you can't have, that you can't express. I feel that very strongly. If you're not going to toe the feminist line, you really best speak very, very quietly. And so what you have is these couples making these decisions mostly for the women to look after the children and the men to invest in their careers. And the reason why those decisions are being made is not because of some inherent sexism in either the structure of society or within people's minds that they just think this is how it has to be. It's because that's what works for the majority of couples.
Tad, what are your thoughts on that?
Getting hit with a lot of truth bombs today. It's hurting. It's really hard listening to some of this stuff. I guess I see myself as inferior to my partner because I don't earn as much as she does.
Right.
She works in a very male-dominated industry of the mining sector. She works very hard as a fly-in, fly-out geologist in country Queensland. So we see each other very little. We are planning on having kids, three, ideally. When that does happen, she wants me to quit my job to be able to look after the children, because obviously her work wouldn't allow it and she earns double what I do. And I feel like as a man, that would be a failure on my part to not be able to earn money for the household and to instead look after the children.
And when you say it's difficult to talk about, do you mean just within yourself or publicly?
This is the first time I've articulated it to other people.
Right.
But the more I hear, the more I have to realise, I guess, that it makes far more sense for me to be able to look after the kids and to be able to ensure that they're provided for and that the family unit is looked after and that my partner is the breadwinner for the family and that I need to be okay with that.
Ricky, you counsel men. Mm-hmm. What do you say to them about how to be a man today?
Well, as a counsellor, yeah, it's about giving the opportunity to actually be vulnerable for the first time in their lives. Mm. And it's not really about what I say, but what eventually they say when they're given that opportunity. A lot of authenticity starts to come out rather than looking to the, not say the Ninja Turtles and the action figures, but like those people that they're looking up to maybe on social media or celebrities. They can put that aside and actually try to find within themselves some sort of person they want to be. That isn't totally just this complete fabrication, but real and maybe embodying a bit of sensitivity, because working in the mental health space across the board, I think we really need a place for vulnerability to be welcomed.
Mm. If you ever wanted children and you had sons, what would you hope for them?
Just giving boys and girls access to skills when it comes to managing emotions. Part of the work that I also do is speaking in high schools through an organisation called Batia, and I do share my story with fitness and bodybuilding and essentially just tell these young boys who think being shredded and having a six-pack will solve all the problems that it won't. And the real strength is not about necessarily being strong and lifting heaps of weight or pushing other people down, but being able to pick them up and provide.
Tad, if you ever had sons, what kind of father would you like to be?
I'd like to be someone that they can talk to. I'm a suicide survivor and an abuse survivor. And I know exactly what it's like to not be able to talk to anyone or not have anyone to talk to. It's a feeling I never want my kids to ever experience. Mm. And it's something that our society still has not gotten a handle on. We can't talk about it. We still can't talk about it. Mental health is still taboo. No matter how much fanfare we put around it, we still can't talk about it. You can't bring it up at work. If you bring it up with your boss that you are struggling with your mental health, you still have fear of being let go. You still have fear of, you know, responsibilities being stripped of you, or that opportunity that is dangling over your head evaporating. Mm. It's especially as a man, it is very, very hard to be able to talk about those things. And so if I was to have young men, I'd want to make sure that they knew that they could come and talk to me at any point in time with no judgments and no anger, and I'd be there for them always.
Given the challenges you've faced, do you feel equipped to deal with life as an adult, as a man?
Part of me wants to say never, but look, I think I have lived through a lot. I have experienced a lot of things that people shouldn't, and I've had a lot of opportunities afforded to me that I'm very fortunate for. I think as I go through life, I'm learning. I'm always going to be learning, and I'll do as good a job as anyone else. So whether I think I'm ready, no, I don't think so. Life is really hard because it gives the test first and the lesson afterwards. Mm. And so I will do my best.
Thank you so much. Thank you to you all for being here tonight, for having such a respectful, open discussion about a tricky topic. Thank you too for joining us. Please stay tuned. Dateline is coming up next.